It's the time of the year that people are talking about weeds. Some experts will say a weed is just a plant growing out of place. I get their point. Some people will say a weed is an indicator of something. Other people will say a weed is a sign. We have many people that say weeds are medicinal plants that are used for healing. I believe all these people are right. But one thing to think about is a weed has a completely different appetite than a food plant. To be more specific, if you have weeds, undesirable plants, growing within your crop, let's just take a look at your crop. And it doesn't matter if you're growing watermelons or radishes or carrots or soybeans or corn or alfalfa or walnuts or olives or grapes. Weeds are a problem, the undesirable plant. The food crop that you're growing, it loves and needs available calcium and phosphorus. Those are the two minerals needed to start the process. Once you have available calcium and phosphorus, then the plant wants to make sure it has carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen. Okay, those five things, calcium, phosphorus, carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen, make up the handful, the core, the beginning, the fulcrum, the foundation, the basis of what a plant is made of. Guess what a weed doesn't like? It doesn't like available calcium. It doesn't like available phosphorus. And it does not like carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen in elevated levels that your crop does. So when you see a weed growing, you can say, ooh, we must have a calcium deficiency or a phosphorus deficiency or a carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen deficiency that allows that medicinal, not nutritional, but medicinal weed to grow. How do we know this? Well, one of the last videos, we talked about a refractometer. And a refractometer is a very simple piece of equipment. And if you've never heard about it, you're in good company because a lot of people haven't. It's a quite recent development. The first refractometers were created by Dr. William Bricks for the wine industry to measure the sugar content of grapes to have consistent, wonderful wine. And this was created back in the mid-1800s. This has been shunned. It's been giggled at. And they said, oh, it's not very accurate. Oh, it's a bunch of crap. It's like, oh, I don't know. Other people that have gotten a refractometer and checked their plants, they said, I've had one of those goofy things for 15 years and we haven't figured out any way to make it move. Well, one way to make it move is checking a weed compared to your food crop. A food crop really isn't a food crop until you're at least at 10 bricks, B-R-I-X, or 10% sugar. What I mean by that is when we look at this, I'm just going to put a little water on the top of this prism. There's the blue plate there. You put a couple drops of water on there. Close the lid and look to the light, and the light will refract through the blue prism of glass and show you exactly what the sugar content of, let's just say, this water is. Obviously, this water has a sugar content of zero. Why am I talking about all this? Because when you get a really high-tech piece of equipment, and if this looks like a dirty old garlic press to you, you're exactly right. You can grab some leaves and some stem from a weed. Yes, a weed. Cut out the center of it, cut out some leaves, stick in the garlic press, squeeze it on there, and what you're going to find that plant, that weed, that undesirable plant, this weed that everyone says is the problem, you'll know what its blood level of sugar is or the liquid that it's working with. Weeds do not like a sugar content over 10 bricks of sugar. Okay, if you remember just a couple minutes ago, food plants really aren't food until they're above 10 bricks of sugar. If you check your weed and the weed is two or three, and you check your crop and the crop is two or three, my first question is, what are you fertilizing for? Because a weed enjoys a many times low calcium, low phosphorus, low carbon, low oxygen, low hydrogen environment, low sugar, low carbon. Sometimes it enjoys a compacted area. Sometimes it enjoys a sandy area. All of these things can contribute, and you have to create the environment to grow food versus weeds. So as we walk through our fields, grab a weed, squeeze a couple drops of juice, and take a look. And what you'll see is there will be a clear-cut line between the blue and the white. And that clear-cut line means there isn't much mineral in that solution. It's just sugar, even though it's low. If you squeeze your healthy food plant, and it's much higher, and it's kind of hard to determine which what number is odd. Is that a 10 or 11 or it could be 12? When it fades from one color white to the other color blue, that's a good sign because that's mineral deposition that is also combined in that sugar water or in the sap of the plant that provides nutrition. So when you squeeze a weed, it'll be a clear-cut definition. When you squeeze a good healthy plant, it'll be almost a graduation. It won't be a clear-cut line. As we look at this, we can relate that back to many different things. This time of the year, if you're putting up hay and you're putting up alfalfa hay, you want to look at your relative feed value, RFV. And if you're putting up grass hay, you want to look at RFQ, relative feed quality. I asked a lot of growers that grow a lot of alfalfa and grass. It's like relative feed value, relative feed quality. What's it relative to? And they give me the deer in the headlight look. They go, what do you mean what's it relative to? And I said, well, it's a relative feed value. It's relative to sugar content. If you want a higher sugar content, you have to have the nutrients that do that. What are the top five things that help a plant build sugar? Calcium, phosphorus, carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen. Those five things. I didn't say nitrogen. I didn't say potassium. There's other minerals that are important. Those are the first five to focus on. So many companies are trying to give you elaborate productions of, well, you have to do this and you have to do that. And it's like, let's go back to basics. Because what we find is when you go back to basics, what a plant is made of, you can start understanding. So when you start looking at a weed, there's a weed book called When Weeds Talk. Now hang on. You're probably thinking, oh boy, what kind of a Fruit Loop deal is this going to be? The author of this book, Jay McCammon, was a wonderful agronomist. And he talks about different weeds, and he talks about what they enjoy and what they don't enjoy. As we go through this book, you'll see there's highlighted weeds in here. These are weeds that we have naturally eradicated by looking, focusing, and increasing five things. Can you possibly guess what those five things are? Calcium, phosphorus, carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen. It's what weeds don't like. It's what weeds don't want. So no matter what weed you look at, you can find that the environment that these weeds enjoy is a very low calcium, very low phosphorus. Most weeds enjoy high potassium or high magnesium. What am I saying? Create the environment. Engineer the soil. Make a place the weeds don't like. And you can start practicing your wave, because as you get your food crop two and above 10 bricks of sugar, the weeds will slowly be fading away. Another thing to look at when you're noticing weeds, the weed that's growing in your field is a problem, but it isn't the problem. If you have pigweed growing in your field, you have a phosphorus deficiency. If you have yellow mustard growing in your field, you have a salt or sodium problem. Kochia is a weed that is trying to extract salt and sodium from the soil. Foxtail, wild barley, ticklegrass is also a plant that is trying to extract salt or sodium from the soil. When we hear of chemical resistant weeds or super weeds, let's be honest, that environment has been created to grow them. If you have chemical resistant weeds, or if you have a super weed, it's super screwed up soil. You're low in calcium, you're low in phosphorus on the available basis. You're low in carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen. How do we check these things? Well, I live and die with this, the penetrometer. Checking to see if the soil can breathe. Your soil has to be between 100 and 150 psi of surface tension to allow air in and out of the soil. You got to check your carbon to nitrogen ratio. You need to have carbon 16 times higher than your nitrogen for the microbes to actually do their job. Now, when we talk about the microbes doing their job, something comes into play. What we're looking at, and yes, by the way, we have spared considerable expense with these wonderful visual aids. A plant needs to make sugar. And this is the chemical formulation for sugar. So if I'm a plant and I'm laying its leaves out, it's like, oh boy, I gotta make sugar because that's what makes a plant sweet. That's what gives the plant defense mechanisms against disease. That's what keeps plant feeding insects from chewing it up and destroying your crop. So I'm a good healthy food plant. It's like, okay, my job is to make sugar. I never got a manual. Nobody ever said this in the meeting. I didn't get the itinerary. What do I need to make sugar? You need carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen. Where can all of these things come from? Well, guess what? If microbes are breathing in the soil, they give off CO2. CO2 is what we exhale, and it's also what microbes exhale. Carbon, oxygen, huh? That's part of the whole thing. If you have enough carbon in your soil, that carbon will start stabilizing the hydrogen and will lower your pH. pH is a deficiency of hydrogen, which is a deficiency of carbon. If your pH is too high, you're deficient in carbon. If you don't have any hydrogen on your base saturation, you don't have any carbon. If you don't have carbon or hydrogen, guess what? The plant doesn't make sugar. And then he wonders, like, gee, we're always spraying fungicides. We're always spraying killicides. We're always having problems. Why? Because the plant is starving. It doesn't have the raw ingredients to make the fuel it needs to protect itself. So if you have microbes in the soil, eating, breeding, partying, doing their thing, huffing and puffing, giving off CO2, this goes to the system. If you have carbon in your soil, that will stabilize water. Water is always a problem. Hydrogen and oxygen, more components of the sugar. Do you see how this system can be simplistic? CO2, the exhalation of microbes, can become very inexpensive if you're within 100 and 150 psi surface tension of your soil. If you're over 200 psi, you've got none of that. So what happens if you have if you don't have enough CO2 because the microbes can't breathe? This is carbon dioxide, CO2. What happens if we take away one molecule of oxygen? Now it's gone from carbon dioxide to carbon monoxide. But it gets worse. If you have some carbon in your soil and you have no oxygen and you throw some synthetic nitrogen down, carbon and nitrogen in an anaerobic or oxygen-less environment form cyanide. Huh. Wonder why my crops aren't doing so well. There's cyanide, there's carbon monoxide in the soil just because of surface tension, just because of too much pressure, just because of compaction. Now, here's the thing. No tillers, full tillers, minimum tillers, ridge tillers. However you're farming, you probably have compaction. It isn't about just driving a piece of equipment over the soil. It's the electrical compatibility or incompatibility of the minerals within the soil. Magnesium is a mineral that initially causes the compaction. Calcium, many times, is deficient in the top inch, 2 or 3 inches of the soil. Calcium is the mother of the soil, in my mind. Calcium's kind of a big old gal, and she only moves down with water. And if the microbes aren't there to keep her up in the profile, you lose her. Whether you're tilling or not tilling, many times that top 2 inches is deficient or almost void of calcium. When the calcium leaves the top portion of the soil, remember the top 5 things that you have to grow food and not weeds? Calcium's number one. If she leaves the top 2 inches of the soil, where do most seeds germinate? Top 2 inches of the soil. If you don't believe what I'm saying, rather than doing a 0-6 or 0-12-inch soil test, do a 0-2. Now, if you're no-till, minimum till, if there's a lot of residue on top of the soil, brush that away. That is not soil organic matter. That is residue. That's fodder. That is on top of the soil. It is not part of the soil organic matter. Clean it away so you just get dirt. Take 2 inches, and I'll bet you a new pair of boots, you'll be shocked at the calcium that isn't there compared to a 0-6. This lack of calcium in the top portion of the soil keeps the plants from making sugar. It keeps the microbes from exhaling CO2, and it allows weeds to grow. If you want to get rid of your weeds, number one, check to see how healthy they are. If you get them to 10 bricks of sugar, they're not going to appreciate it, and you'll quit growing weeds and you'll start growing food. Number two, many times there's compaction in the area, or there could be the exact opposite. If you have beach sand, you will get weeds to grow there because beach sand doesn't have much of this. It doesn't have much carbon. It doesn't hang on to water. It doesn't hang on to these nutrients. It's almost like it's diuretic. Everything flushes through. The weeds are telling a story of deficiency, imbalance, or toxicity. They're just a tool. They are a problem, but they're not the problem. So looking at creating environment, available calcium, available phosphorus, carbon, oxygen, and hydrogen, getting that into the soil will start engineering the environment for your soils to grow food rather than weeds. I hope this has been helpful. I'm Glen with Soilworks. Look forward to talking to you again.